Good morning, my dear students. In the last class, we had discussed experimental method and correlational method as the ways of conducting psychological research. In today's class, we will start with survey research. Now, in the newspapers or even on the television, you must have observed that election surveys are conducted to find out if a particular group of people would like to vote for a political party or a candidate. So, survey research comes into existence to study opinions, attitudes, and social facts. They want to find out the existing reality or baseline. Now, facts may include literacy rate, religious affiliations, income level, occupational status of a group of people, attitude of people towards various issues like family planning or Panchayati Raj. The survey research uses various techniques for collecting information, which include personal interviews, questionnaires, telephonic surveys, and controlled observations. Let us take up all these techniques one by one. Personal interview. An interview is an in-depth conversation between two people, one who is acting as an interviewer and the other who is an interviewee. It is a widely used method and it is a purposeful activity which is conducted to derive factual information, opinions, attitudes, and reasons for a particular behavior. So it also helps to discover how individuals think and feel about a topic and why do they hold certain opinions. Now, types of interview. There can be two broad categories of interview, that is structured or standardized, unstructured or non-standardized. Semi-structured interview, as you can see from this slide, includes that type of interview where certain questions are predetermined in advance, where others are asked randomly. Now, coming to the structured interview. Structured interview is that particular interview where a list of questions are prepared beforehand, and this list of questions is called interview schedule. So we can now discuss the difference between structured and unstructured interview from this particular slide. The unstructured interview, on the other hand, does not follow any sequence and there is no list of questions which is prepared in advance. In the case of structured interview, there is no flexibility on the part of the interviewer to make any changes in the wordings of the questions or the order in which it is asked. The responses also in certain cases are specified in advance. They are called closed-ended questions. But in the unstructured interview, the interviewer has complete flexibility to take decisions about questions to be asked. And since the responses are not specified, the respondent can answer the question in the way he or she chooses to. So they are called open-ended questions. Interview may have the following combinations, like individual to individual, where one interviewer interviews another person. Individual to group, where an interviewer interviews a group of persons. One variant could be a focus group discussion. Group to individuals, where there is a panel of interviewers who are conducting an interview on one single individual. And group to group, which is a situation where a group of interviewers is interviewing another group of interviewees. What are the merits and demerits of an interview? It helps in obtaining in-depth information. It is flexible and adaptable to the individual situations. Interviewing is a skill which requires proper training, and the interviewer should know how to elicit the responses from the respondent. Since it collects in-depth information, it can be used with children and also with non-literate persons. An interviewer can know whether the respondent understands the question. So in order to make the person understand, he can repeat or paraphrase the question. Demerits, it is a time-consuming process. And because a person may take a lot of time to respond, so it is not very cost-effective. Coming to the next method of collecting information in survey research is questionnaire, which is simple, common, versatile, and low-cost self-report method of collecting information. There is a predetermined set of questions which has to be read and marked on the paper, and there is no verbal response which is given to the interviewer. They are in some ways like highly structured interview. So it is a kind of method where a questionnaire can be distributed to a group of persons at a time to write down their answers to the questions and return to the researcher. There are two types of questions which are asked, open-ended and closed-ended. In open-ended question, The respondent is free to write whatever answers he considers to be appropriate. Whereas in the closed-ended question, he has certain specific answers, so he has to select the correct answer. Examples of closed-ended question include true-false, yes-no, multiple choice, or using a rating scale. In case of rating scale, a statement is given and the respondent is asked to give his or her views on a 3-point scale or on a 5-point scale or on a 7-point scale. So the participants are asked to rank a number of things in a preferential order. Now, questionnaire can be used for collecting background and demographic information, information about past behavior, attitudes and opinions about a particular topic. Coming to the next method, which is telephone survey. Surveys are conducted through telephone. Many a times we may have come across telephone calls where the person is trying to extract certain information from us. But what happens is that the respondents do not know the interviewer, so there is non-cooperation, reluctance and superficial answers, which may lead to biased kind of results. But it is a popular method because it is a combination of both telephone as well as computer. The controlled observation is used for conducting surveys. Now, coming to the methods, these merits and limitations of survey method. First, information can be gathered quickly and efficiently from thousands of persons. And secondly, since surveys can be conducted quickly, public opinions can be obtained also as soon as possible. Certain limitations are also there. People may give inaccurate information. And sometimes people may offer responses which they think that the researcher wants to hear. Coming to the next method of assessment of individual differences. For this, psychologists have constructed different types of tests for measuring human attributes like intelligence, aptitude, personality, values, interests, attitudes, etc. The tests are also used for a variety of purposes like selection, placement, training and guidance. A psychological test is a standardized and an objective instrument which is used to assess an individual's standing in relation to others on some mental and behavioral characteristics. Students, we have already discussed objectivity as one of the major characteristics of psychological research. However, the psychological test has three desired characteristics: reliability, validity, and norms. What is reliability? Reliability of the test refers to the consistency of scores obtained by an individual on the same test on two different occasions. For example, if you want to administer an intelligence test or an anxiety test today, and then you want to administer it after some time, let us say after 15-20 days, if it is reliable, there should not be much variation in the scores obtained by the students. Validity, on the other hand, whether the test measures what it is supposed to measure. That is, if you have constructed a test on anxiety, whether it is actually measuring anxiety or not. Finally, the test becomes standardized when the norms are developed. And what is the norm? It is the average performance of the group. The test is administered on a number of students. Their average performance are set according to their age, their gender and place of residence. So this helps to compare the performance of an individual with that of the norm or with the others of the same group. So it helps in interpreting individual score obtained on a test. Now, in case of reliability, we have certain types of reliability, which is called split half reliability and test retest reliability. In the case of split half reliability, the degree of internal consistency of the test is measured. That is, the items of the test should correlate with each other if they belong to the same domain. So it is internal consistency which is checked in the case of split half reliability. Whereas test retest reliability, it is the stability of the test scores over time. So you find the coefficient of correlation between two set of scores on the same set of persons. Types of test. Depending upon the language, we have verbal, non-verbal and performance test, where literacy is a criteria for taking verbal test as the items have to be written in some language. In non-verbal tests, items are made of symbols or pictures. Performance test requires movement of objects from their respective places in a particular order. Depending upon the mode of administration, psychological tests are divided into individual and group tests. Individual test is administered by the researcher to one person at a time, whereas in the case of group test, a large number of individuals can be given the test at the same time. In individual test, the researcher administers the test face to face and remains seated before the subject. So, in the group test, the instructions about answering the items are written on the test, which the test taker reads and answers the questions accordingly. Psychological tests are also divided into speed and power test. In the speed test, there is a time limit within which the test taker is required to answer all the items. So, the time is the basis on which, you know, he is checked. On the other hand, the power test assesses the underlying ability of the individuals by allowing them sufficient time. That is, they do not have any time limit. So, the items are basically arranged in an increasing order of difficulty. Coming to the next method, which is called case study, it is a powerful tool for clinical psychological research. It is an in-depth study of a particular case, and you can conduct the case studies on an individual or on a community, and it employs multiple methods such as interview, observation, and psychological tests. It is a valuable research tool, as I told you, in the field of clinical psychology and human development. So it provides you with an in-depth information, and sometimes unexpected discoveries can be incorporated into research. We can study social behavior, which is not feasible with the other forms of study. But it is very difficult to generalize findings based on one group, and you cannot transfer the findings to another group. Sometimes when the researcher is present while the study is being carried out, it can influence the result. It is difficult to duplicate, and it is a time-consuming process. So you can see the methods in the slides which are used: observation, interview, and psychological tests. The researcher should not depend upon only one particular method. A combination of two or more methods should be used to get the real picture, because every method has its own limitations and advantages. Now coming to the next topic, which is analysis of data, which can be done in a quantitative way or by using the qualitative method. In the quantitative method, for the purpose of drawing conclusions, the researcher may compare individual score with that of the group. And you can also use statistical procedures like mean, median, mode, methods of variability, etc. Qualitative method, on the other hand, it emphasizes on the fact that human beings are very complicated, and the complexity is lost when one elicits information from a respondent on the basis of a question. So psychologists have developed qualitative methods such as narrative analysis, and these type of data, which cannot be converted into scores, just like a video record or a tape record or an informal talk. So the researcher uses the technique of content analysis to find out the categories and builds the categories, taking examples from the data. Quantitative and qualitative research methods are complementary to each other. Coming to the limitations of psychological inquiry, where psychological inquiry do not have any zero point, unlike scientific measurements. Nobody has zero intelligence in this world. Relative nature of psychological tools. Psychological tests are developed keeping in view the salient features of a particular context. For example, if you want to study urban students, they may contain items available in the urban setting like buildings, metros, railways, etc. But it is not applicable to people living in village or in tribal areas. Subjective interpretation of qualitative data. Data from qualitative studies are largely subjective, since they involve interpretation on the part of researcher and the person providing the data. So it is suggested that in the case of qualitative studies, the field work should be done by more than one investigator so that they can discuss their observations and then, you know, come at a proper meaning or a suggestion or an agreement. Coming to the ethical issues of psychological research, we have voluntary participation. The persons on whom you want to conduct the study should have the choice to decide whether to participate or not to participate in the study. Informed consent. The participants in a study should understand what will happen to them during the study. So, information prior to the starting of the experiment or the study should be given. An informed decision can be taken by them in that case about participating in the study. Like, for example, if you want to administer electric shocks, right? So, in that case, you need to give them that information prior to that. Debriefing. Once the study is over, the participant should be provided with necessary information to complete their understanding of the research. They should leave the study in the same physical and mental state as they had entered. Sharing the results of the study. That means you need to share the conclusions with them. Confidentiality. The participants in a study have the right to privacy, and the researcher has the primary role to respect their privacy and safeguard it by keeping the information in strict confidence. So let us recapitulate what we have studied. The experimental method helps to establish cause and effect relationship. The purpose of correlational research is to investigate the association between variables and making predictions. The survey research helps to collect opinions, attitudes, and various kind of facts, social facts about different issues prevailing in the society. It uses techniques like personal interview, questionnaire, telephonic survey, and controlled observations. The psychological tests are those standardized and objective instruments that help to know one's standing in comparison to others. The basic characteristics of a psychological test are reliability, validity, and norms. The method of case study provides in-depth information about a particular case, which could be an individual or it could be a community. The data collected through the use of these methods are analyzed both by quantitative methods and qualitative methods, where quantitative methods use statistical procedures and narrative methods and content analysis are used in qualitative research. There is a lack of absolute zero point, relative nature of psychological tools, and subjective interpretation are some of the limitations of psychological inquiry. And while conducting a psychological research, you cannot force anybody to participate in a study. There should be voluntary participation. There should be informed consent, and you need to share the results with the participants. Also, the confidentiality of his information must be maintained. So with this, we come to an end to this chapter. I'm sure the various methods of research are clear to you. Thank you and have a good day.